Hey, everybody. Welcome to this episode of Inside Microsoft Teams. I'm your host, Stephen Rose. Thanks for joining us. Got tons of great feedback when we asked all of you, what would you like to see for season 7? And thanks for taking time to respond back to us. What we heard is, we want to know about a wider range of products and projects, not just Teams, but all the things that attach to it, from Power Platform to SharePoint to OneDrive to Teams Rooms, NTRs, etc. And one of my favorites was, I want to learn more about frontline workers. So this week, we're kicking off the first in our series of double clicks. These are shorter 15-minute shows that will each week deep dive into one of these topics. And we'll have several of these. And this is our first for frontline workers, because you asked for it. We're going to talk about planning and deploying. But, you know, I don't really understand the difference between an information worker and a frontline worker. There's some nuances there. And I thought, who's a good person to help walk us through this? And I thought of one of my coworkers and my friend, Zoe Hotoff. So Zoe is joining us today. Hi, Zoe. Thanks for joining us on the show. How are you?
Good. Thanks, Stephen. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So what is a frontline worker and how is that different from an information worker? Because sometimes these kind of get lumped together as, well, yeah, if you work for a manufacturing company, you're a frontline worker, or maybe you're an information worker. So how do we look at the difference between the two and, you know, sort of guide ourselves through that initial conversation?
Yeah. So unlike, you know, maybe you and I, right, where we're sitting behind our laptop today, maybe at home, maybe in the office, we characterize frontline workers much more based on less of the creation of their information and more the consumption. And a lot of that is tied to either them doing task-oriented work or service-oriented work. So they're the people who are, you know, standing on a retail floor as your sales associate. They're a nurse in a hospital. They're a manufacturing operator who's on the plant floor. And they're really focused on either the task or customer at hand rather than, you know, making sure they respond to the latest email that's come to them from their colleagues. And so when we think about frontline, it's really that mobility and it's really focused on delivering the front end of the business, whether it be completion of a task or, you know, really working with customers and being the front of people's brands.
And these can also be shared devices that we often see with this. I know if you go to work in a retail store, they hand you a phone device and that's where you're figuring out, you know, what's in the back and what other stores have things and things like that. And I know we can leverage Azure Active Directory, which allows that easy signing in and out. But is that kind of one of those aspects, is you generally don't have your own PC, it's a device or a shared device. And if it is your own device, you're probably using it off hours for personal stuff, but also for things like scheduling and communicating and things along that line. Would that be correct?
Yeah, we see a mixture of devices. While we'll sometimes see frontline managers having a dedicated device, like what you and I have, right? We tend to see frontline workers doing either shared devices where they, you know, clock in, clock out, hand it over, or they bring their own device and they kind of use that while on the job. So we see a mixture of it, but fundamental to everything, as you said, is really that identity piece and making sure that they have access to the right information, but also restricted in the right ways.
And that can create a lot of problems and pain points because you have high turnover in retail and you're looking at a mobile device versus a laptop and sometimes a personal device. Some may be corporate owned, some may not. And as we're looking at that, then do you think about how to deploy Teams and what parts of Teams to give people differently from an information worker as we look at a frontline worker?
Totally. Yeah. When we talk to IT pros about deploying the frontline, like you said, turnover is a huge aspect, but also just the size, right? We tend to see in industries ratios of 10 to 1 frontline worker to information workers. So not only do they have turnover that's either seasonal or, you know, just the natural part of the frontline employment, but they're so big that it makes it a, you know, tough deployment problem. So the innovation that we've really been leaning into is how do we connect? So we're not only bringing in the right information from your systems, like your HR systems, but also how do we help you doing auto provisioning, both onboarding and offboarding, so that you're not having to kind of lean in there every time one of your thousands of frontline workers potentially, you know, moves on or is a natural turnover.
So let's talk about auto provisioning, and then I want to go to a demo in a minute. But how is that different from the way that we're provisioning teams today?
It's the same process. What I would say is that the most important thing that we want to hit on is bringing in the right frontline information that might not be as pertinent for provisioning a information worker. So we think of three core information as really essential. It's the role, their location, and their department, which, you know, can be very applicable for information workers, but is especially important for frontline. And so we've made a lot of investments connecting to HR systems like SAP SuccessFactors, as an example, to have that bi-directional flow of information. Yeah.
So static structure, working with templates, and being able to support those 3P apps. All right, let's take a look at a demo.
Like I noted, it's really important about bringing those three attributes, roles, departments, and locations, because then you can map the frontline real world into the digital world. And as I was noting, and you know, Stephen was also noting, we can easily do that by integrations with the human capital management systems you already use, like Workday and SAP. You can all do that through auto provisioning with Azure Active Directory. So I'll walk through a couple, just a quick way of how to get it connected. And then from there, I'll walk through how to go even further into the team structuring. So to initially set this up, the IT admin goes to, you know, the Azure portal, which is something you probably have already been using. And you just click on one of your supported HR systems. So in this case, we're going to click on SAP SuccessFactors. And from there, you can choose to provision user accounts. So you just enter your SuccessFactor credentials. And then upon validation of a successful connection being established, you'll just get a notification. After that, you get provision logs. That lets you check the status of the sync in case, you know, everything has been added successfully or if there have been any issues. So in this case, it was all success of connecting your SAP SuccessFactors with AAD. And then finally, you go to the user section, which is also within the same Azure portal. And you can see which workers have been onboarded onto the HR system. So what this really allows you to do is you can automatically sync and maintain accuracy. So your HCM system serves as a system of record that will automate any downstream workflows with confidence. So you can easily both onboard and offboard your frontline workers to make sure that you are kind of staying consistent across all of your different systems. So now we're going to talk about bringing that information from the HCM system into your team structure and creating a team's environment specifically for your frontline. First, prepare the two CSV files, which can be imported directly from your HR management system. So this one is about 100 test tenants. You have to fill in that team name as well as define it as public or private, and provide a template. In this case, it's blank, so it's a generic Teams template. From there, the user CSV shows that it's 10 users per team, and that the first two teams has 3 owners and 7 members. From there, the PowerShell shows the deployment command, which takes 3 inputs, the team CSV location, the user CSV location, and email ID for notification. And finally, the confirmation email will show a successful deployment. In the Teams Admin Center, you see the teams created. So let's look at the first team. We see that there have been 10 users added in successfully, which is 7 members and 3 owners. Once the IT pro deploys, they can stay notified regarding the success of their deployment. So they can easily make sure, you know, if there's any necessary corrections or redeployments necessary, they'll be notified of that need.
And, you know, I know we're going to be doing other episodes and going deeper, but of course, before you do any of this, it is really important to audit and survey your workers, understand what features they're going to need, train them on how this is going to work and come together so that once you push this out, they're ready for it, they understand it, and of course you see the success with that.
Yes, we see a lot of success from customers who go in and really speak to their, you know, frontline managers or their, you know, district managers of operations to really see how their teams work together, to really help figure out, you know, what does that structure look like, member to owner, and how should we think about making sure the right environment is created from the get-go for the frontline that can be scalable.
And vice versa. We've also heard of a lot of frontline workers who have gone to management and said, hey, we're using this feature, saw this plugin, we think this would help. And it's really that back and forth that can do it when the end users feel they have a stake in it. That is really critical. And that's something that you've heard again and again. And you folks did a blog on it, which we'll talk about in a minute. But that's also a really key point, that there's listening on both sides, correct?
Totally. Yeah. This is the only way to go forward, is to actually understand the pain points that both, you know, our IT and our admins have, as well as our frontline workers and managers, because in the end, we're all trying to solve for the same problem, but coming together is the best way to really figure out what that is.
Awesome. So of course, go to docs.microsoft.com, click on Teams, and you'll see a lot of what we just talked about today. You have a great blog. We'll put the link in the window on how Microsoft Teams empowers your retail workers to do more with less. But it's not just about retail workers. It really applies to any variety of frontline workers. Anything else we should point folks to before we say thank you and close out this episode?
Yeah, there is some great documents on both the auto provisioning and connecting it to your HCM systems, as well as the deploying Teams at scale kind of flow from CSV to PowerShell to the admin center that are also available on learn.microsoft.com.
Perfect. Zoe, thanks so much for kicking off our DoubleClick series. And we're excited to have you back, because you and I are going to be talking about communicating and collaborating, some of the cool things that you can do with Teams in a later episode. So I'm looking forward to that. So we would love to have you back.
Me too. No, I'm excited to keep kind of chatting with you and with everyone around how we can keep empowering the frontline and our, you know, admins and IT that are, you know, behind it all.
Awesome. And we're listening, of course. Use all of our vehicles, social media, user voice, all of those to let us know what we're doing right, what we're not doing right, and how we can always do it better. So again, thank you, Zoe, for joining us. I want to thank all of you on this special episode, our new DoubleClick series on Inside Microsoft Teams. Reach out to us, email, Twitter, however you like. We're listening. And thanks for joining in. Share the episode if you like it. And we'll see you on our next episode of Inside Microsoft Teams. We'll see you there.